stated that the current 10-year road plan will tackle the worst roads, and then the next 10-year road plan will take on the next set of worst roads. So that's not incorrect, I may have said it exactly like that, and here's the source of some of it. It's not like a 10-year road plan that started like now, and then 10 years from now we have another 10-year road plan. It's a planning tool, so it's like a CIP. We have a 10-year road plan today, we'll have a 10-year road plan a year from now, we'll have a 10-year road plan a year from now. It's a rolling plan, and so that allows us the ability to take a look at what's up in the next 2 to 3 years or whatever, and to make adjustments. So however you want to manage that.
What letter was that?
It was under F.
On the 14th, on the 21st.
That's what I thought when you were saying school and that you was not.
So under letter I, Kim Sandler asked why the vehicle fuel budget line was only half expended. Jeff Sanchin stated that last year was a bad winter, and so that saved money.
Oh.
I think it was not
yes.
a bad winter. So I agree with your comment on J, Nancy. And so say that as you stated, current workers will be paid $14 an hour while new hires will be paid $18 an hour. I'm quite sure he didn't say that. The line was calculated based on that budget, but
yes.
we're not, we're not going to hire somebody at $18 if we don't have to.
Right, it's if needed.
It's, yes, exactly.
So if needed.
Yes.
That was up to $18
so,
if needed.
Yeah, that's right. So you've got, I agree with you. Oh yeah, and then under the operational budget, so number three, letter B, this had to do with the detail under the legal line, and Vern Crozier asked if the town reviewed welfare every year, as he would say that the town does not. So that's confusing. What I think what you were asking, Vern, is if we had legal review of our welfare policy every year, and I said no, we didn't have it last year, so now we're going to do it this year. And letter E, Kim Sandler asked about the information systems line, whether it was new, and who were stated it was the Avatar software system. That's true. I think it would be clearer if we said that was in the revaluation section. That's the revaluation and appraisal section. It's
okay.
Not, there's a IT section in executive, and that line is not new.
Okay.
This
got moved.
It was not a line that got moved. It was a new line in the revaluations appraisal section. And the rest of the comment is correct. Oh, yeah. And G, letter G was, and I had this figured out, so you'll have to bear with me. So the select board has changed the town's employee policy so that new employees will employees will no longer receive compensation for sick leave as of January 1st, 2017. Old, new, no one gets compensated. Current workers of record on 12/31/16 will have their eligible accumulated sick leave recorded so that we can pay them back. So it's not, so that's a little different from what's here. Then in anticipated revenue, 2017, letter A, that is correct. Never mind. That's fine. It's not being reduced by 10 cents. It's being reduced to minus 10 cents. That's right. That's what I stated then. Okay, I think that's it. Thank you.
recorded all that, right, Cory?
Yeah.
Okay. Are there any other changes? Oh, here we go.
I just, she did one of them for me. It was under 2G. I'm confused. Kim St. Helier asked how many bids the town received, and shouldn't that be for roads?
I think it was roads.
Well, that was, yeah.
It, I thought it was, parents. We were talking about roads at that point.
That's all I have.
Yes.
I'm obviously coming in late, but was it mentioned about putting who was absent? Normally it says who was not here.
I think Nancy already said that.
I didn't do it this time, no.
Oh, all right. There are two absences tonight.
I meant the other meeting.
That's missing from the 21st.
Yeah, from the 21st.
Yeah, I generally don't put that in.
It's on the 14th, that's why I.
Okay.
It should be recorded. Excuse me.
Should I?
Excused or not excused?
Okay.
So you and I were excused. I don't know who else wasn't here.
Generally, no one tells me who is excused and who isn't excused, though.
Well, usually if we mention it.
You do, usually.
They're excused, but if someone is missing without leave, then we sort of make note of it because you're allowed four absences unexcused, and then you're off the committee. So it became an issue for a while there.
It was Denise and Michelle, correct?
Yeah.
Just normally it is there.
Normally I catch it.
Are there any, anything else? I have to get back to the agenda. Okay. I've got so much stuff in here. Two, if I didn't. All these emails will go back and forth.
It's the only one I didn't print out.
I thought I had the thumb drive that has all that data on it, and I left it all in the other computer. What?
Are you all set with the agenda?
Yes. Your agenda?
Well, I can.
Oh, okay. Got it. All right. Review proposed fiscal year 2017 town, that's the wrong one. See what happens?
Review of proposed more articles for town and the school district.
Ah, good. Who didn't print them out or bring them with them?
I did not.
Okay.
I have some extra school ones.
And school. Michelle needs some.
Thank you.
Town.
I have it here if people need copies, but.
You need copies? Who else needs hard copy?
Did you have a five version of school?
Denise, Judy has.
Did you send an electronic version?
Alan sent the electronic version out. I do have some hard copy of the school ones if necessary.
And if you just answered them, maybe today.
Maybe today.
I sent it out today, and I don't remember.
Yeah.
Got it. Thank you.
And there's an extra town one here.
Those are all town ones, right?
Does anyone need another copy of this? Anyone need a school?
Because this is a town.
I got an extra school. Okay.
No, it's from that town.
No. All right. Can we start with the town portion of this page, the warrant articles?
What is it that you'd like me to do?
Well, I have a couple of questions. One is, I read through the warrant articles for the borrowing because we don't know yet what it's going to be. And I compared it very carefully to what municipal association says it has to be worded, and it was perfect.
This is from our bond council.
Right. And it, Steve.
Buckley.
Buckley.
Buckley, yes, know that. He wrote one and wrote it out, and I'm sure they're trading these back and forth between lawyers. There is one question I have, though, and that is, you haven't completed, you haven't secured funding yet.
Correct.
And you don't really know which one it's going to be.
That's why it's written the way it is, that you can, you know, such sum to be raised through the issuance of bonds or notes under an compliance with the Municipal Finance Act, blah, blah, blah.
Right. There's an additional sentence you have to add, if there are any payments to be made in this fiscal year.
Understood. We're not anticipating any from our, either the bond bank or USDA.
Both of them are talking about 2018.
Correct.
Just one of those little keys that have to be crossed and I's that have to be dotted. Just suggesting.
I have a question.
Yes, go.
In the event that it doesn't pass for the bond, is there any, one of the articles that you're going to pursue to be out of tax dollars, or would just not let them come through or?
Is there a plan B? No, there's no plan B.
But they are split in thirds, so one might pass or two.
Yeah, there are three, so, okay. Right. They're independent warrant articles, so the fire engine could pass, the other two could fail, or any combination thereof.
But don't you have to have $1 million in order for it to
sense? I was talking that way at first, but that's not how it works. So each bond warrant article stands on its own. It gives the select board the authority to go out and secure financing. So if all of them pass, then we can bundle them together to get the combined financing as a possibility. Mm-hmm. So it'd be one application to the bond bank, you know, or it could be three different. It gives us the ability to mix and match, bundle as we choose.
Okay, so on the two-thirds, it's because it's going to be financed versus coming from tax dollars. So
it's long-term financing because of it's a bond
or long-term
financing. So not necessarily a bond. Right?
Okay, so if one passed and two didn't, you could still secure a long-term financing.
Correct.
For that one sum.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes. And the only other thing to add is for the culvert bond warrant, it does say that $50,000 will be coming from the culvert replacement reserve fund in support of it. You know, I'm going to come back to what you just said, Vern, about the interest payments. I mean, it is true that the two avenues that we looked at don't have any interest payments until 2018. But what if something else turns up?
Well,
so
if town meeting has come and gone, you secure the financing from some other place and it says, well, your payments will start in October, you can't do it. And in addition, if, let's say it's a bond, and you want to start before the bond actually sells, and you want to do a bond anticipation note, that would have to be in that warrant.
Yeah, but that gets rolled into the bond, from my understanding with the bond bank folks.
What, not a bond anticipation note?
Well,
that would come from a separate source.
Right, but the interest that you've paid on that, that was my understanding from a conversation that I had with them. So, but I'm going to go back. So I may change those three warrant articles such that they do have something in there about interest payments, just to make off chance that.
My experience with USDA is they sell bundled securities like twice a year, just like the bond bank. And you would either have to wait until the bond sold, or if you wanted to start earlier, you'd have to do a bond anticipation note, which has interest.
Yeah, they're not bonds from the USDA. These are loans.
Beauty.
They're loans, so they're not bonds. And we would either either know before town meeting on a couple of them or right after town meeting. It doesn't mean that, doesn't mean we have to go through with the warrant. It just means that they will have, you know, blessed or not blessed our loan application.
Okay. Now, do they have, they, you, with bonds, there's two anniversaries, just like the bond bank. But do the loans have that same?
The loans, I asked, and there were no interest payments until 2018.
Okay.
But you're giving me a moment's pause just in that case of what if we, something else comes up and we do it a different way, that perhaps we should put something in there. I'm just thinking about, I have to talk to the board. I have the language from the DRA, because I asked her for that, so.
If we put the language in, does it limit us? Or can we just throw it in there, and if we need it, we need it, if we don't?
No. If you had, for instance, if you had a bond anticipation note, you have to be specific about how much the cost will be. You can't say, or any interim financing. You can't be that vague. Because you're asking people within the fiscal year to commit to a certain dollar amount.
Right, but the clause we're talking about is just in the instance where we might have to have an interest payment in 2017.
Then it's got to be in that note.
Yeah, that's, so the two avenues that we're currently following don't. But, you know, if in the case that they don't, they aren't successful and there's some other mechanism, I'm wondering if maybe we shouldn't have that in there. So
then it's got to be specific.
I don't believe so, but I'll check with our bond counsel. I've talked to her. This covers the whole gamut, other than the possibility of having to pay out interest. So I will talk to her about that.
Well, principal or interest, it doesn't really matter. If you make any payment in this year, it's got to be in that warrant article and specified.
Yes.
And they're very specific about that. Because if you had a bond, you'd have an amortization table and say, starting in 2018, you're going to make principal interest payments as follows. But if you do an interest, like a bond anticipation note, for example, there's going to be a cost potentially in this year, and it's got to be specific, and it's got to be in the warrant article, according to Steve Buckley.
I will check with bond counsel.
Okay.
And he, when we called him about another instance today, said you should really talk to your bond counsel, not to us.
Right. Well, they're not advisors on.
They're
this
not
was a general advisory in
yes.
Town and
correct.
Village or whatever that magazine is of theirs. I'm done.
Yeah, I'm open for questions. I mean, everything else is pretty much as we did excise the two town hall maintenance items that had been possibly a bond warrant. That one was for the shingling for the town hall roof, and we are paying for that out of $2016. And the other was a potential boiler for downstairs. And if that happens, it will come out of an energy performance contract, which is probably not likely, but we'll just, not likely for 2017, but we'll address it in 2018. So there are three bond warrant articles.
Now, what you sent us as a draft is pretty much, that's it. There's no other major surprises coming.
Well, other than this clause about interest that I have to talk to bond counsel about, but I mean, as far as different additional warrant articles?
Or changes in the amounts?
No changes in it. We're not making changes to amounts.
So this...
The amounts are what the board has blessed.
Okay, so this draft is essentially, except for that one clause, final.
Yeah, we still have to consider it a draft, but yes. I mean, it represents the board's appropriated request, budget appropriation request.
So we can pretty much rely on these to
yes.
be what's going to happen.
Yeah, yes. I mean, there, you know, there's the zoning article, there's...
I know where they don't have a financial impact.
Right.
Just for the budget committee,
yeah.
All I care about.
Yep.
You put that puzzle together. Okay.
Yes. So what we're saying here then is the money amounts that are in here will not change, so we're considering these as...
As if they were final.
As if they were final?
From the board, yes. Correct.
We can take that to the bank, so to speak.
So to speak.
Go ahead.
So, in the event that the fire engine warrant article does not get approved, do you have any estimates for replacing the engine and the transmission in that vehicle?
Can't be done. You can't find parts to the transmission.
No, not repairing it, replacing it.
Replacing the engine and the transmission.
You have to talk to the Chief Rutherford. This is the engine that is however many, 30 years old.
89.
Yep, 1989. It's on a wing and a prayer with regard to the transmission. And you'd have to, it would have to be a question of him. I don't have an answer to that.
So we never got estimates for replacing those things?
It was not deemed to be economically feasible.
So we did get an estimate then?
I don't want to say yes or no. I can only say that this was the chief's recommendation. He spoke to this group, the budget committee.
I wasn't here that day.
Well, you know, I'm sorry. I wasn't here that day either.
I was.
Yeah.
I remember the, what he had said was the, and I can't remember the gentleman's name who does the work on the truck.
Sam.
Said that he can't, he monkey rigged it this time, but he can't do anything if it goes.
He can't repair this one, that's true.
He can't get parts, he can't even fake it.
I'm talking about a complete replacement of the engine and transmission.
And warrant. Yes.
I was present when Chief Rutherford presented to the CIP committee. And because this is so, it's a different type of transmission, they aren't making them anymore. They stopped making them, somebody else might remember, 20 years ago. It's so that they can't replace, it's the transmission, I believe, and they can't replace it. They can't repair it and they can't replace it, according to what I believe I heard that night.
I think what he also said was that it's not just the engine and transmission as well, it connects to the pumping system, which you couldn't replace that either. I mean, as in, when you replace the transmission, you're not going to be replacing the pumping part of the truck. So it wouldn't solve the problem by replacing just the engine or the transmission.
Yeah, it wouldn't be able to pump.
It wouldn't be able to, it's a whole different system when the truck, for the pumping side of it.
So there's
and
no,
it's 30 years old.
There's no backup plan, basically. If this fails and the engine goes down, we have nothing.
That's correct.
Correct.
Okay. Do you have any more questions on warrant articles? Any more questions on the warrant articles?
One.
Yes.
This is a really big bite for the town this year. Had you considered any of these, like a priority on any of these, in terms of what you really need to have versus what is nice to have when you...
Well, the things that are there from the CIP were pretty much there from the CIP, scheduled to be... I'm going to repeat, the tax impact is, for the municipal tax rate, is zero at the moment. It's zero. So I'm not sure when you say bike, exactly what you mean. I mean, yes, we're spending money. We have revenue to cover it. The tax rate remains with a zero increase for the municipal piece of it.
So you're anticipating $115,000 in revenue every year to cover this, is what you're saying?
Well,
additionally.
You're talking about the loan repayment?
Yes.
If you looked at the 10-year projections, yes, you could see that we keep within this sort of manageable kind of range, which is why we did the 10-year projection, so that, you know, the board could see what we were doing. And now that we've reduced the possible total bond note to closer to $1 million instead of $1.1 million, it reduces that annual payment by about, probably projected by $10,000. So, I mean, I'm trying to be recalcitrant, but I mean, I don't know what the bite is. You know what I mean?
Okay, if you were put against the wall and said you have three bonds, which one do you absolutely have to have? It's like that saying, which is your favorite child, I know. But if you were pushed to the wall, what would it be?
This is a plan that's reasonable, that addresses public safety, that addresses infrastructure needs for the town so that we don't run amiss and have stormwater flowing into the Salmon Falls River that creates operating efficiencies for the transfer station. So, you know, I let the town figure it out. The board is confident about what it's proposing. We think it's a rational, reasonable plan. We hope the budget committee feels the same way. If it doesn't, we'll let the town make the final decision.
Right. You love all your kids. Bill?
I agree with Suzanne 100%. This is, I don't think we should be picking at, you know, what do we think is the best or needed. That's a decision for the voters to make. My personal opinion is I support the whole thing. I think it's long overdue, and we need these things that are in here. You know, and it seems a good time to do them if the tax impact is going to be zero. So let's do it. Let's get it done. Again, I feel we've kicked stuff down the road for far too long.
And let me just make another statement. So the reason the tax impact is zero is that the three bond warrant articles are going to be covered by the proceeds this year. So then we worry about the payback, right? And that's what you see in the projected spending. Then from the rest of the items that are here, obviously the operating budget has a tax impact. The road resurfacing has a tax impact. Article 9, town hall drainage, covered by the CIP, zero tax impact. Town hall security, covered by grants of the CIP, zero tax impact. Public safety communication, covered by the CIP and tax and grants, zero tax impact. The command vehicle, zero tax impact. The service truck, zero tax impact. Then the capital improvement, of course, comes from taxes, you know, the fund.
I had sent an email today asking that we put tax impacts on the warrants.
No.
Why not?
The guidance from the DRA is to put only what is statutorily required to be part of the warrant.
We've done this in the past.
And we were probably advised at some point by the DRA not to do it because we haven't done it since I've been on the board.
Why would you not do that?
Because the guidance from the DRA is to make your warrant article contain only the amount that is statutorily required, period. That's why the zoning articles don't have explanations. They're just, you know, we're doing what the DRA has told us and advised us to do.
Well, what about helping the people who are voting on these understand?
Well, why couldn't we just have, you know, an announcement or something that indicates, you know, this letter that you had talked about sending around at some point, we could do something along those lines that said, here's the warrant articles, and the tax impact is, you know, up and down.
We are planning a voter's guide. We're getting quotes now for mailing it out, so the board is planning a voter's guide.
But that way it would be there rather than here. DRA is telling us not to do it, then let's not do it, but let's put it in a voter's guide so that people have the information. I agree with you. It's valuable information to have, but it's just a question of where it belongs, I think, as well.
Yeah. Well, put a handout next to the copies at the meeting. I would think it would be in your favor, especially where it's zero tax impact, because as a person who's not really up to date on this, they're going to come in and say, oh, that's a lot of money, but they don't know that there's no impact. So wouldn't that be advantageous to you?
We're going to follow what the DRA recommends. And the other thing about the tax impact is that it's an overall, you know, the impact on your taxes, whether it's an increase or a decrease, it's based on your revenue, it's based on your expense appropriations, and it's based on your the overall assessed value of your property. And so, you know, sometimes it can be misleading. So it says in the budget that I presented, and it will say in the voter's guide, these things are coming from the CIP or from state grants, and it also says the overall tax impact is neutral or zero. The overall tax impact is neutral or zero. I mean, I don't know how else to be clearer than that.
I looked it up. RSA 32:5(5)(b). Any town may vote to require that the annual budget and all special warrant articles have a tax impact. As determined by the governing body, shall contain a notation stating the estimated tax impact of the article. The determination of the estimated tax impact shall be subject to approval by the governing body. So,
you don't
says you can do it, but you got to pass it. Yep.
Dennis St. Lair, it sounds like we're hiding something. And I think we should have that. Why not give the voters something to, this is the March meeting, am I correct?
Yes.
When nobody goes?
Yes.
At certain groups?
More going.
So SB 2 is knocking on the door. So if you want to get this done, you're going to have to get it done this year. That's all I have to say. Can you hear that?
Get what done?
Get these warrant articles through.
I see what you're saying.
You know what I'm saying?
I do, yeah.
Okay. You know what I'm saying?
I don't agree with what you're saying.
No, but that's what's going to happen. Okay.
What's going to happen? I'm sorry, I'm.
No, no, I was just going to say that if SB 2 comes in next year, you're probably not going to be able to do a lot of things that you want to get done.
SB 2 for town?
Yes.
Oh.
Am I right?
I think you'll have a broader.
Participation.
Yes, that's what I mean. There's, nobody goes to these town meetings anymore, you know, I mean, it's just a few people. Am I right? Well, I don't think, I thought the last town meeting we had really, really, really was bad. It sucked.
It's less than 10% of the.
Okay, less than 10% of the people.
That's what I like about you, Dennis, you're so hard to understand where you stand on the subject.
I think it's being facetious.
But I think that's always the way. People don't come, people don't go to the general elections.
There's no freaking pocket.
You know, what's the.
I think we should have them at the Legion, so.
But anyway, if we can, I mean, is there anything more about the town's warrant articles? Let's move along if we can. Good. Now let's talk about the school's draft articles.
Yes.
Are we tonight voting, taking a position on this, we're recommending or not, or we're just kicking this around?
We're kicking it around. Not down the road, we're kicking it around. Because we want to make sure we're clear, you know, everybody's read them, everybody's absorbed them. We know there's not going to be any major changes in the town.
But you're taking a stand after Saturday's meeting.
Correct.
On the school part.
Saturday is the school, that's right, sorry.
We're February 7th.
Yeah.
Right. Okay.
Okay, so on the school warrant articles, I can report that there are no petition warrant articles that will be on the ballot this year. None were submitted as of the 10th, end of business on the 10th, so there are no petition warrant articles going in. This is, these are draft, because until they sort of pass through the budget committee, they remain draft until they are recommended or not recommended at the, by the budget committee. So they will become undraft, they will become actual after Saturday's meeting.
Saturday's meeting, we're going to recommend or not recommend?
Right, that's when they become, that's when they become.
They have to be finalized.
That's, yes.
No.
They are final, the numbers are not going to change on any of these.
Swear to God.
Yeah.
Okay, then I have a question. This has to do with Articles 9 and 10. I have a proposed change I'd like to see. Last year, you're going to need that. Last year, the warrant articles were a bit vague about what year you were going to take the $25,000 from. And it ended up, you took it out of a prior year, FY '16, to put it into FY '17. You did.
Yes, it came out of the '16 budget.
Right. And these warrant articles are for the FY '18 year.
Yes.
These warrant articles, right.
'17, '18.
Right, everything except for those two.
What two?
Yeah, this is the, and this is something that we can discuss further actually on Saturday. I think that's why we have the Saturday discussion of it, but since you're not talking about the actual budgeted amount, these are attorney-approved warrant articles, which is why they're not going to change.
Okay.
I'm happy to have the discussion But on Saturday, when our business administrator is there and other folks are there who can help answer the question, I remember last time that these are the way they've always been worded was kind of the answer, and these are what the attorney approves, but.
It's never been done before that way. I'm just, okay, I'm giving you the rewording, but it's just with specific dates is what I'm suggesting you consider.
And I believe the dates would be the sum balance to come from the June 30th, 2017 balance to be transferred on the 2018. It comes out of the fund balance from.
The prior year.
No, yes.
The current year.
Yes, yes.
Not the year we're voting on.
You are correct. You are correct.
Not the year we're voting on.
Fund balance.
Right.
Much more than the prior year.
Yeah, it makes sense from the end of the year.
Right.
Right? That's what you're saying.
Yes, we're taking money that is not spent out of the 2017 budget and moving it into a, it's not fund balance essentially, but we're moving it then into an account for special accounts, right? A school district is not allowed, a town school district is not allowed to have a fund balance. So, no.
No, they can't.
No, we are not allowed to have a fund balance. We can't carry it year to year. This is how we use money that is left over in 1 year, and we put it into a special account for special ed, or in our case, one of them is special ed and one of them is the school, the building.
You could refund it to the taxpayers as an offset.
Yes, and we often do.
There is, there happened, I mean, I did find out as part of our own discovery that the school district has been returning money to the town, fund balance.
Right. My concern is that this warrant article is for the 2018 fiscal year only. Doesn't touch any other year, because you can't, because that's a lapsed fund. And I'm concerned about making sure that the money from 2018 is used, not from 2017.
No, at the end of the year of 2016-17's budget, June, end of year, that budget, and then it goes into the account. It's not touching 17-18's budget. It's
right.
Going into the account at the end of June, if there's money left over from their budget, this goes, these two articles go before returning funds to offset taxes.
Correct.
That's exactly what
that is. Correct. That is how it is indeed done. And
right. Go first, then Nancy.
And because, and I think this would be a great topic to discuss on Saturday, when the business administrator is there.
And it's also if money's available.
Yes,
okay.
If money's
so if
available,
money's not available,
it doesn't happen.
Nothing happens. Okay.
Right. Correct. Correct. Right. And the school warrant articles are also in order. I mean, they go in order,
yeah.
Partly because it's if, you know, if there's money available to do these things, they will be done. And that's why the 9 and 10 are in the order in which if there's only $15,000 left, it would go to the special ed fund rather than to the capital improvement fund. But that's very important.
There's a reason for the way that
there's a reason for the order of them, yes.
Okay. The concern was brought up by me last year because we had voted that the town had voted down recommending the $25,000 and the $25,000. And it was
2016.
In 2016. So I was under the impression where it didn't have a date on it, where we voted it down in 2016, that the money wouldn't have been drawn out of last year's budget to be put in. And that was because there was no year on it, it didn't really say what year it was being drawn out of. Whereas we had, the townspeople had said no to it. And then it was still taken out. So that was my confusion as well.
Yeah, they said no to it in 2015. In 2016, they said yes to it.
Right.
So yeah, so in 2016, we didn't put any in from 2015. It's kind of hard to follow.
Who would have their hand up first?
I wanted to ask.
Okay.
So Suzanne just said that the school has been returning money to the general fund. Mm-hmm. Did we see that in revenue somewhere? In a line item for revenue?
You see it in the tax rate that we get.
How do you account for that in your bookkeeping system?
It's not a subsidiary ledger, it happens at the fund balance level, and so it is, so you're not seeing it as revenue when we print out revenue, you know, quarterly revenue or those kinds of things. But it's added to fund balance, it's, you know, you can see, should see it in our financial statements, it should be there.
In the annual reports?
Sure, somewhere, it seems to me, it should, or maybe not the annual report, but in the financial statement, which is more detail that we get from our auditor.
Can we get a copy of the last several years on that?
I have to, I have something to add.
Wait, Michelle first.
Sorry.
Unless she wishes to see, she concedes.
All right, I just want to add to that, that this is something that actually took the school board a little bit by surprise, too, this year, so, I mean, not surprise, surprise, we knew we were returning money to the town, but we didn't know where it showed up. So we asked them, we're trying to become more budget savvy and where all the money's going. And so we did ask, and we received, I just have a small piece of it here to show some of it, but in 2014, the taxes based, and we get this from, the DRA provides this to us. In 2014, the school returned, the taxes were reduced by $210,000 because of school balance, because we're not allowed to have a fund balance, only the town can have a fund balance. In 2015, zero, the taxes were reduced by zero because it was the first year a school district could retain a certain amount of their budget to use in case of emergencies. However, that money was then immediately used and made available to, then immediately becomes available to the district in 2016. And then in 2016, the fund, the taxes were reduced by just over $30,000 by money being retained, the money we retained earlier. This year, I'm sorry, the last year, it gets very confusing the way it all, I try to do a chart here to see it, but it's not, right now we have available to us from the money we retained last year, we have just over $100,000, and if we don't use it, and chances are we won't, because we had an unexpected savings this year, chances are we won't, it will be returned to the town, that over $100,000, because we can't do anything with it, it has to be returned to the town.
Could I just, historically what happened is, the town makes periodic payments to the school district for tuition. And usually what happens is either one of those payments or the last payment is reduced by that amount. That's how it's mechanically done. So it's not a truly a bookkeeping entry so much as a reduction of an expense.
It gets modified for the remaining years of a month, that are, they do it monthly, and it gets modified.
Right.
And then and it gets reduced by what?
Correct.
They don't
so we've got
actually
a check
write them a check for the amount that they
no
have left over.
Yeah,
they just reduce
that
the amount.
We had a different schedule and starts
the
number
yep
or
from the last one down.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
That's a follow-up question.
Wait, oh, Michelle's been waiting patiently.
That's okay. I just, and it caps at 100? Is that right?
No.
Cap or 200?
Percentage.
It's a percentage.
Oh, it's a percentage.
The percentage that we can retain.
Right.
And not return to the town or not do anything with it. Because town school districts are not allowed to carry a fund balance, just a couple years ago, the state gave us the option
right
of retaining up to 1.5% of our entire budget, if we had it, if it was left over, and holding it. So we hold it. It's held in a special fund, not by the school, but by
yeah
somewhere. It's held somewhere. So that if the roof caved in,
mm-hmm,
then we would have to come, we would have to do the things you have to do to use money specially, come to this body, go to the DRA, get approval to spend that money to fix the school roof. And that's after we've exhausted every other part of our budget.
Like no, but I thought there was a cap on
yes
what could be in that fund, though.
It is. It's like 1.5%. I can tell you. It's like whatever percentage, it's a percentage of the... it's like 1.5% of the entire school budget.
And that's all that can ever be in the fund.
Yes. Oh, yeah. And it goes to zero. It goes to zero at the end of the time period. Absolutely.
And so I thought it had an actual amount versus a percentage, but it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
I think the point that I would like to make is that it really reduces taxes anyway, even in that fund, because if the roof collapses and you have to come up with the emergency money, we're going to pay it no matter what.
True.
So if there's a way to have it there that it can be done and it comes back anyway if it's not used, it's, to me, a smart way to do your budgeting.
Yes.
So, does, that kind of maybe explains a bookkeeping, maybe a bookkeeping question for me. So the proposed budget for 16-17 is like 5.2 million-ish, mm-hmm. right?
Mm-hmm.
But the actual is 5 point, well, actually, but this reflects 5.5 million.
That includes the warrant articles. Once the warrant articles are passed, they get added into the actual, okay. But not into the, not obviously not into the budget because it hasn't passed yet.
Okay. And so you're expecting $100,000 savings in operating budget this year, potentially?
You can see that, you can this year, yes, we had an unanticipated resignation at the end of last year, so, and we did not replace that teacher. Luckily, we have an educational model that we didn't have to. The school scrambled. As many, anyone who's a parent or grandparent knows, the school scrambled in June to make it work because they knew that the board was not going to support replacing that teacher at that time. So so we have a savings of about, that is a savings of about $100,000 that is in this year's budget.
Can you tell us what the balances in the sped reserve right now?
The two reserve accounts.
Yep, the two reserve accounts, I can. I have it here. I just have to see where I put it.
Can you kind of click?
Put things out.
Okay.
Yeah. Because they only put in if they actually have designated fund balance, right? So I did some math, and I think it, I might know what it is, but I don't know exactly.
All right, in the SPED, in the special ed account, we have just over $130,000, and that has to be put into perspective. If we have one out of district placement, it can go up to $200,000. We are already talking about where do we want to cap these at if we don't use it, and so that will be something that we will be bringing to you next year, what we expect to cap it at. But we still feel, the reason we're asking for a little bit more is we still feel that this can be anywhere up to $200,000. We may choose to cap it a little lower than that, mm-hmm. so that we don't do this in the future, but that puts it in perspective. If we get one out of district placement, it becomes very bad.
Just
and then,
I'm sorry, follow up on that. But didn't you have $190,000
no,
unanticipated spend this year?
A reduction in cost from commercial.
Yeah, well, that's a reduction in cost, right? That we see as a reduction that doesn't get spent in the that we're not budgeting for. It's been reduced, so
okay.
We're not budgeting for it.
Okay.
This is in case of emergency. This is not special ed can happen in an instant, mm-hmm. and it can change in an instant. We have one out of district placement that was changed four times on Monday.
What?
Four times on Monday. So anything can happen. And that's when court costs get involved and everything. So this is barely enough to feel comfortable with, I think, for emergency situations.
Oh, sorry, just to follow up to that, have you ever had to draw from that?
Not in my time on the board, we have not, and I don't know about beyond that. So this is insurance, so to speak. And again, we have to reduce the rest of our budget before we can use it, I believe.
You also have to get permission to use it.
Get permission
from the
to
town.
Use it. I mean, this is not something yet. And in the building, it is right now at just over 78,000.
That's a weird amount.
Yes, ma'am.
I know it is a weird amount. Well, but a year ago it was at 53 for some reason. I don't know why.
Bill, Article 8, $80,000 to extend electricity. I mean, surely it's already got electricity.
All right, so maybe that's poorly worded.
Is this
a
three-phase continuation?
It is. It is to complete the
okay.
three-phase piece. It is, and if you think that's poorly worded, we can, you know.
I do.
Again, we can discuss that.
Yeah, it almost sounds like, you know, we're stringing a wire out there.
We're trying to get rid of that damn wheel.
Yeah, it should say extending three-phase.
Yeah. Yeah.
It should say extending three-phase, but we will... also make sure that that's done with when our business person is there as well. But it is, and it really is completing the project, which is wonderful.
And that's also to the kindergarten, right?
Yep, it's the whole, it's kindergarten, the whole thing, yep.
Jessica?
Just generally, so, sorry, back to the sped budget. So you had $190,000 in unanticipated sped costs this year, right? You plan to kind of keep that in your budget for sped costs this next coming year?
Well, whatever you see, what we budget for, it's very difficult, as you know. We start working on the budget in earnest in October, when the school year, this school year has barely started and is going to take effect the following school year, I mean, a year from the time that we start working on it. And all we have is a very small sample of even this year, as we start to experience this year. So, but we base our anticipated costs on what our current needs are. We don't, what we use, if something unanticipated happens, this is when, this is why we have this sort of this insurance policy there. We don't say, well, and then maybe we better add 10%, or maybe we do, maybe we better fudge it a little bit. We don't do that. We actually base it on exactly what we anticipate will be in place in the coming year.
So actuals.
Actuals. And of course, what we don't know, of course, are the youngest ones coming in. You know, we don't, what we can really, we can base, you know, we have a pretty good idea of, but we don't know who's gonna move into district. We don't know what court-ordered placements might happen into the district. We have no idea.
Are you still talking about just?
Just special ed.
Special ed, I hate that term, sped.
Just special ed.
Special ed, just special, okay. Because I was gonna say, you are putting in a pad for contingency for the high school, junior high school, high school.
This year, you're right, this year we are adding three, as we discussed when we discussed the budget, we are adding three contingency students.
Not special ed.
Not special ed, base tuition, just over $10,000, $10,400, whatever it is, that they're charging us next year.
Yes, Kim.
I'll just keep rolling.
Back to you.
Do you have an objection to providing proposed tax impacts to your warrant articles?
We won't be putting them on the warrant article, but as you know, we handed them out to you at the time when we presented the school budget, yes. And you received them, and we will be making them available, yes.
Okay, great. I'll have to look back through my pile of paper then, because I don't remember seeing them.
Okay.
And on the actual operating budget, it's easy to see, based on the operating budget, we are almost 1% lower than we were last year on the operating budget.
I noticed that the tuition kind of almost made it flat. The decrease in the grade school and increases in the high school and the middle school is an offset of like $48,000, basically.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting when we see the chart as they come in closer together. I would say next year, they're probably gonna be together.
Yes.
No, let them go.
I'm gonna go, wanna talk about the teacher's contract. So is that?
Yep.
Okay. And I apologize, I think I missed the meeting for this, but the healthcare agreement, where, does the percentages change of who's, how much is being paid by each party?
That's a good question, and Michelle actually raised it at the time when it was did. What the union, it's not just teachers, it's what the education union has agreed to do, is to move to a much lower cost health plan. And so we did not change the percentages that each party paid. In order to save the over 40, in order to save close to the $42,000 that we will be saving from their agreeing to move to this lower cost plan, they would have to pay 20% more of their current plan, 20% more. I mean, that's pretty amazing. And that's very unlikely that they're going to agree to do anything like that. So this was the big bang for the buck, was to get them on a lower cost plan. Then years will go on, and so no, it is staying the same.
Okay, follow up?
Yep.
If this does not pass, mm-hmm. will it cost the town more money?
Yes. Okay. In terms of The insurance, I believe, went up, I think it was under 10%, but it went up 10%.
Okay. Would it increase more than the proposed total of 21-something, 21,615?
I do not know.
Okay.
I do not know. I believe that the agreement that the union has supported, and I can only say bless them for doing it, is a real savings to this town. $42,000 a year. If we don't save it, we're paying at least $42,000 more next year, this coming year, than we have to, and $40,000 more the next year, and the next year, and the next year. I mean, even if in our wildest dreams, we think Rollinsford Grade School is going away in 5 years, that's $200,000 that the town could have saved.
And I agree with you. I'm just, how this get, you know, the discussion when it comes up and so forth, I think, you know, we have to go down in this way, even if, you know, because the long run, we get the cost down. But I'm afraid that people will see any increase and say no, and it hurts us in the long run because.
Yeah, that's a good point. So how do we let people know that this is an important savings for the town going forward?
From experience in pricing out insurance, is this a new carrier or just a new plan with the same carrier?
This is a new plan.
But the same carrier?
It is through School Care, yes.
Okay. Thanks. Well, Dennis Engel there. What do you do about a buyout? Is that private information, like they don't want the insurance, or why is it?
Oh, no, that's in the contract. It's public.
Oh, it is?
Yes.
Okay. What do you, offer them? I know we do it all the time.
You know, I didn't think to bring a copy of the contract with me. I think it's about, it might be $1,500.
Oh, wait a minute. What are you talking
about? If they choose not to use our insurance, in other words, if a single person chose not to use our insurance, it would cost, so it costs the district $10,000 to provide insurance. If they choose not to use our insurance, it's in the contract, we will pay them $1,500 not to use our insurance.
Okay, well, there's an impact under the Affordable Care Act. You can get whacked with a required minimum coverage thing, so. They're obviously going to get covered someplace else, like
yes.
Home.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Have you ever thought of increasing that?
Yes, we have. We've offered it. We offered it in our last negotiations, and we thought about offering it with this negotiation, but we decided to keep it very, very, very clear. We wanted it to be about the health care itself. The problem is, we have a very small pool of people who take health insurance. We have maybe 20 people. So we have a very small pool of people. The people who are not taking it are already not taking it. If we end up paying them more not to take it, we're losing money. We need to have at least a certain number of people choose not to not use our health insurance. And we have it's a very small pool, very small pool. But it's a good thought. And.
Yeah.
I know one person gets $1,750, so I'm not sure if it's the same union.
And that could be it. That could be it.
I think it's $1,750 they get as a buyout.
That could be it. Again, I don't have. I know it's under $2,000.
Yeah.
Because I know we've talked about. We talked. I don't want to give away our negotiating strategies, but we've talked about raising it.
So this health savings is good for 1 year, right? Guaranteed 1 year.
Once it's in the contract, we are not changing insurance for 1 year. We are changing insurance in the contract in perpetuity.
So potentially this could go up next year.
Oh, these savings?
Yes.
Well,
sure. The cost for.
Well, sure, the cost may go up, but so would the cost. So would the cost of what the current plan would also go up. If health insurance costs go up, both plans are going to go up. If insurance costs go down, both plans would go down.
So
yes.
So
what we're doing is getting that differential down.
Right. So the salary will always go up. Every year we'll pay that. We'll get a 1 year reduction in the health costs.
This salary,
guaranteed.
This salary here, the difference, and so let's call it the 21,000. That's not going to be every year. This is a one time step increase. For the teachers who are not on the proper step that they belong on the teachers that they're required to have on, in the contract.
So it's a one-time payment?
This is a one-time payment. That $21,000 is a one-time payment.
So kind of like a bonus, almost?
No, it's not a bonus.
I say bonus, it's not something, it's not recurring.
It's not recurring. That is correct, it is not recurring.
However, it doesn't mean you won't get a raise next year when you go back into negotiations.
That is correct.
Based on the whole, but the teachers did not get a raise this year.
That is correct.
Only certain people have got.
There's no salary increase this year.
This contract, it's 1 year. That's all there is for that 1 year.
What wasn't clear is that it's not a recurring increase.
And these are good points. I appreciate what you and Bill are bringing up, because these are ways to talk about it with the town as well, that this is a one-time expense to get a number of teachers to where they belong contractually on the teacher's salary scale. But there is no salary increase being given this year, that is true.
And you said five teachers?
It's about five or six, I think.
And ends up being, I think you said potentially.
5%.
Per step or track?
Five-step, five-track.
Okay.
So if it's teacher got a track and a step in the same year, they would get 10%.
Yes, and I would also like to point out.
They did get their tracks, because they get tracks.
I would like to point that they also have agreed to go step or track. And that's very, and that's also, no, not and, which it has been, so again.
Well, only for a couple of years, because it was, when I was on the board, it was always.
But it will be in the current contract. If this passes, it will be in the current contract. I mean, the contract doesn't change unless the money parts of the contract change, so.
Suzanne?
Maybe I had stopped listening, so I apologize, but, I mean, if somebody gets a step increase as part of this contract, if it passes, they will still have that step increase the following year. It's not an additional.
Right.
Yeah, it's the same as the savings, right? Or just at a different base, whatever the base is.
You've raised the cap, that's all you've done.
But you don't get a step if you don't have an approved contract. And that's why they fell behind.
That is correct.
So it isn't an automatic, the track is, they get the tracks.
Correct.
As part of the operational budget.
That is correct.
So, but that's why they're paying catch-up.
Yes, that's why we're so far behind on a few teachers.
Yes, Bill?
Just a suggestion, again, I think healthcare costs are so volatile and critical that I think it's important for the school board or us to make sure we get some information to the voters and say, look, in the long run, this is going to help us, because it's going to help control this. And make sure we look at the healthcare savings that we're getting out of this, and not simply the bottom line of, well, it's a, you know, $21,000 increase. Because I think people may look at just that and say, no, just because of the money issue. So I think it's important to make sure that information gets out, either in a voter.
Yep.
Voter's guide.
Thank you.
Voter's guide thing.
Thank you.
Thing is all I can come up with.
I think the only thing that's guaranteed about this plan is that their salary is going to raise, and that's going to stay, right? But we don't have any guarantees that we're going to continue to see these kinds of savings year over year in healthcare. So Bill says long-term, but this isn't really long-term, this is 1 year.
Sure it is.
But you never see, I mean, I don't think you can ever say healthcare costs, what they're going to do.
Right.
We're always, for right now, we're always paying for a healthcare plan. This plan, as I understand it, is less expensive. If this is Plan B, this is less expensive than Plan A. So next year, Plan A will go up X number of percent. This, if it goes up the same percentage, it's still less than what that would have been.
Right.
And that, I think, is the key thing.
Exactly.
It's a change in plan, so that even if costs go up next year, the increase will be less than what it would have been had we stayed with the.
The base.
The original plan.
Right, the base.
And that's my, what I think is important on.
Nancy?
Okay.
And then we're going to leave this behind.
Putting that into perspective, if they come in next year and decide that they don't want that lower health plan.
No, it's in the contract, they would have to negotiate a different plan with us, and chances of the board saying, oh, sure, we'll agree to pay you more.
Okay.
Sure, we'll agree to go back to, no, we wouldn't.
Yeah, okay.
The idea is to save money, and I cannot commend the teachers enough for, the union enough for agreeing to this. I think it is huge in this day and age of it's the only way they could say they are a small group of people, there is very little they could do to offer some savings to the town.
Okay, are there any other matters about the warrant article from the school? Are there any matters in general about budgeting that you have? Comments, questions, concerns? Okay, yes.
Not in budget, no. I have a further business if we're getting ready to be done.
Further business?
Just a comment.
That sounds grim. Yes, Dennis?
Could you accept the water and sewer budget?
Oh.
Please.
Since they've been level funded for how many years?
A long time.
Can we just say it?
I mean, if you want.
Well, we're not recommending anything for budgets tonight.
Oh, I thought you had to.
But, you know, there's no hearing on the water and sewer district like there is for the town and the school.
Why is that so? Just curious.
Don't you have your own hearing?
Shouldn't there be?
We have a hearing in March, yes.
And you have your own hearing, don't you?
Shouldn't there be a hearing before the annual meeting, just like us, just like the school?
We do have a.
But they're not part of the annual meeting.
Water and sewer district budget?
Oh, I'm sorry, they're not.
Do we want to have a hearing like?
If it's a regulation, if it's RSA required, we should.
But they have their own hearing because they're user funded.
We're separate from the town. But we do go to the town and present our budget when, at the school with the town when they present their budget.
Right, and we have to make a recommendation to take forward for your April public hearing and meeting.
The last Tuesday in March, if you want to attend.
Thank you, Dennis.
We have our meeting.
Now, wait a minute.
You were supposed to be there last year, but you never showed up.
I'm not in the water district.
Oh, you're right, but she'd like to come. Lorraine Hanson's always with us, so she's not in the water district.
Dennis.
Did she?
We're very aggressive.
Dennis?
Yes.
Hearings are by the budget committee, not by the district.
Okay.
Okay, so you may have a hearing, but it's not a budget committee hearing.
Okay.
Okay. Other than that, then there's some housekeeping things we've got to do here. But I think Bill's got something on his mind.
Well, not on this. It was, my point was the, for those who are, terms are expiring. I think the filing period opens on the 25th of January, if those who want to run again come up. Because I know some people have missed that in the past, so I just bring that.
When is it closed? No one.
It's 10 days.
It's 10 days. It is the.
Oh, it might be 7.
It's the 25th to the 2nd, I think.
Yeah, that sounds right.
Yeah.
25th.
Who is up?
Does anyone know what the date?
I know I am.
Last day is the 3rd of February, just to declare.
Which is called a Thursday? Usually it's a Thursday.
It's a Friday.
It's a Friday, okay.
So, for those who are so inclined to rejoin the club, if the voters.
February 3rd is your deadline.
It opens the 25th.
25th to the 3rd of February.
I think the town's the same dates.
Yes.
I also have a couple other matters thing. I just want to remind everyone here, in case any of you are coming, the school board meeting tomorrow is at 7 p.m., starts at 7 p.m. due to the ability of getting everyone there. Some people have some conflicts in meetings, so it's going to start at 7 p.m., not at 6:30 p.m. And how many copies of the school budget would the budget committee like to have at the Saturday, hard copies?
Hard to guess.
What do you usually do, you know? And I would say certainly not more than, I mean, they're expensive. It's expensive to print them, so.
Black and white this time, okay?
I don't know. It's whatever they have. So, 15?
Good question.
20? I don't know. I mean, we'll use them, obviously. Well, if it doesn't change, we'll use them going forward as well, but if we pick them up.
Well, we also use them in the Liberty section.
Well, yes, if it doesn't change, yes.
Right, okay.
I would say 20.
20, okay.
And if you have not already, will you send an electronic copy, or do we have that already?
You should have it. If you don't, if anyone would like an electronic copy, it is certainly available.
Yeah, I would.
Wait a minute, of the school budget?
Yeah. Do we have that already?
We should.
Okay, I don't know, because there's different versions and that.
Yeah, we're not gonna do anything until.
It's the town that went through 47 different editions.
Okay, so if we haven't, then great.
So 20 copies on that, thank you.
Version eight, yes.
So Suzanne, you had mentioned that you're thinking about doing a town brochure about what's.
We do, it's in draft at the moment.
Yep. Does it include the school?
Pardon?
The school, does it include the school?
The school will do its own.
No.
Okay, you're gonna do one as well. Excellent.
It's our plan, well, we'll be discussing it at tomorrow night's meeting.
Excellent.
Because we have now a much shorter timeframe.
I just have a quick.
And I did, I'm sorry, one other thing.
I just have a quick question, I'm going back, just a quick one on the town. Did you make any changes to the budget on the town? Because I believe you had said that you had changed something Monday night on the budget.
Not the operating budget.
The capital?
Well, we had, from a prior version, if you recall, we had, there were two possible town maintenance capital projects, the shingling and the boiler, they're off. We, the transfer station bond warrants were in two, and we consolidated them.
Yeah, but I thought you had said there was something to do with the fact that, with the capital, there was a different, you had to change a number on something because of the balance, the difference in what you were.
Sure, we removed two items.
So the balance of something else changed.
So there, you know, it's, if you look at the warrants, the you know, the Microsoft Word version of a warrant or PDF, whatever you have, that is now reflected in the capital budgets piece, but it will be different from what I handed out two or three meetings ago, in what I just said. The boiler and the shingling are gone, roof. The transfer station items have been consolidated, I think rounded up to 190,000 instead of 188, but that's reflected in the town warrant. It's reflected in the warrant, that's what that you see tonight.
The town warrant says 188.
Not the one I handed out.
Transfer station improvements, 188.
Is this not the latest?
It is, it's the only one we have.
I've got 190.
Yeah, that's.
This must be an old copy.
Does it have a date or anything on it?
Yeah, so mine says 190, which is the.
So put that.
Oh, no, this side.
No, that's different.
It's the one I sent.
It's the one they cut out.
It's the one that you just sent out, correct?
Yes, yeah. And it was re.
That, you sent that out?
I sent out a draft version, so, and it's been resequenced.
The fault of the article and article N, now it's numbered?
It's now numbered, and may change again, the number may change again, if we get a petition warrant article.
Oh.
So, and if there is more than one zoning article, we don't know yet about the zoning articles, so.
Okay, but the monetary warrant article.
No, they're not, sorry, I misunderstood, the raise and appropriate amounts are not changing, from what I sent out.
The dollar amount warrant articles are not changing.
And the operating budget warrant article, the operating budget.
Well, that has dollars in it.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay?
Good. Yes, Bill?
The school district, December 14th, 2016, version four, that's the current version?
That is the current one, yes.
Perfect, thank you.
You do have it, good, thank you.
I do.
Harry?
Just, you mentioned the zoning, if there are any articles for zoning board.
Yes.
Would those also be included on the guide that is sent out, anything?
No.
Because that's, I'm just mentioning that last year.
It was complicated last year.
A lot of people, you know, they didn't, that was the first time they were seeing it when they came in to vote and.
The planning board hasn't held its public hearing yet. You know, they're following the timetable, so they have to hold a public hearing, they have till, I don't know, sometime early February to let us know what they are. So, I mean, things, you know, things don't always come in at the same time, you know, we accept them when we get them, and as long as they follow the appropriate, you know, date deadlines, then we'll make adjustments. So what could change from the version are the numbering of the town warrants, but the raise and appropriate figures are not changing.
Okay. That's it?
Yep. Are we in the other, are we in the other business section?
Not yet. Well, I just want to do the housekeeping thing now. Saturday morning, 9 o'clock, the school is the public hearing run by the budget committee to hear comments about the school budget. Okay, be there or we'll come and get you.
There it is. And I'm sorry, I have a question on that. I mean, we are, the school, Alan or myself are planning to present if you would like us to.
One of us.
Well, yes, it would just be one of us. No, it would just be one of us.
Okay, now, after that meeting, after that public hearing, we go into deliberation about how we feel about the budget for the school only. Okay?
Yep.
Just so we're clear. So block out your whole Saturday morning, go to the transfer station early. Yes, Dennis?
I'll be leaving at 11:30, so I'm just telling you that because I got something to do.
Not asking, telling.
So I hope we can get done before 11:30.
Okay.
Am I demanding too much?
Okay. Are there any other questions?
You people all right with that?
Okay, other business, and then I'm going to say, I see Ed's back there, and then Ed's willing, wants to talk about something, so let's do other business first. Yes?
Can I talk about roads?
The things I drive on?
Yes, the things you drive on. So here's some copies. I'm going to have to keep one, I'm afraid. So I was curious about, you know, the Barrington numbers that you mentioned at the last meeting. And I think I said that I have brought Barrington to the fore with regard to road maintenance, merely to show that they put their road maintenance in the operating budget. But you had some numbers about, that were interesting. And I don't know whether...
Can you email that to us? So then you don't all have a copy.
Not now, though, because the wireless in here.
It's awful. Yes, so anyway, the discrepancy between the town of Rollinsford maintained paved miles and the Barrington ones just, it kind of didn't make sense. And so I wondered if you were referring to lane miles, and we have mile miles. And so I got the DOT road data set from SRPC. And so Barrington has, we have, the town of Rollinsford has 17 and a little bit more paved miles that we manage, and Barrington has 60 and a half paved miles. And so if you look at our, if you look at the green highlights there, the paved budget in for the town of Rollinsford was 250,000 and that for Barrington 750,000. So the average for paved mile was more last year for this current year for Barrington, I mean for Rollinsford than for Barrington. And then underneath, you could see the either past cost per paved mile and anticipated cost per paved mile for the town of Rollinsford. And so you can clearly see that starting somewhere about 2015, we're making a concerted effort to invest more money in the roads, because up until that time we were spending about $5,500 per mile paved road for maintenance. But as you follow down that list, where, you know, there are a couple of years where it's expensive. This is an expensive year, and next year is an expensive year. But then, you know, it starts to fall back down again. So just there for your enjoyment. No comments now required. Let me just look at that.
Good well, actually the 121 lane miles is what John Scruton told me about.
Yes, but they're lane miles and not mile miles. And so if you have that, you get 60 and a half miles in there. And they have a lot of unpaved roads that they manage.
You need to factor that in.
Yeah. So. Okay. But again, you know, please remember that tool, that 10-year road plan, is a planning tool, and it's a window. Mm-hmm. And it's not like we're going to do everything that's on that in 10 years and go like this. We may not do everything that's on there in 10 years, because next year we're going to look at it again. We're going to look at it in the context of our planned operating budget, of our CIP that year, of whatever our bond repayment is, so that we keep things manageable. So we have some, we can't mess around with the bond repayment, but we can look at our CIP, our road, in particular our roads, and then the entire operating budget.
Did I see Ed trying to make a comment back there?
I can wait till next week.
Next week, there won't be a meeting.
There won't be a meeting, this is it.
Yeah, but the public hearing.
Public hearing, you can say.
I've got you few kindred spirits here. And I'm ready to unload on you, I need a larger audience. So, not that you're not very important, I should say, yes, I could take another 3 hours, but I know you don't want to take 3 hours.
Shall we pencil you in for Saturday morning?
Well, is it on the school?
I haven't even looked at your school budget, so I am sure that as the first member of the taxpayers elderly association, I will be able to speak on behalf of myself. I can't afford to speak, but it's wrong.
We'll pencil you in.
When I see I get a 0.3% increase on social security, and I have a negative rate of return when we adjust for inflation, I assume it's the same for the town.
Okay.
I hear from gathering what I gather here, I don't really see that.
Okay. We'll see you Saturday morning, be prepared. Is there anything else which may properly come before the budget committee? Apparently not for Dennis. I will entertain a motion therefore to adjourn until Saturday morning at 9 o'clock, bring your own coffee.
So move.
Bill moves. Who seconds? Michelle seconds. And we are adjourned at 7:55. Be careful, it's hard for your hands.
Okay, you know the allocation line item budget for ECC?
Well, with them. Yes.
C-O-I.
Yep. And then the